Well, if you haven't figured it out already, I'm going to talk about genes, I'm going to talk about soup, all right? I'm going to talk about the biotech food that is coming to your table or, well, the biotech food that is already at your table. You know what? There is a big debate about it, you know, whether it's good, whether it's bad. What I find out is that when I go to public forums, and I do a lot of that, and I talk about GM food and biotech food, it's surprising to know the amount of people who don't know anything, not only about GM food, but about the food that they buy every day in the supermarket. You see, they come to me and they say, Jimmy, why are you complicating my life, you know, with all this GM food? What we have now is perfectly okay. And the truth is that this is not a proper question, because in this question you are assuming that what you have today is perfectly okay. What do I talk about? Well, I'm talking about that what you have today, your normal food in the supermarket, is natural, is old, is traditional, and is safe. And above all, there is plenty, plenty of food for everyone. All you need to do is go to the supermarket and buy more food. That's it. Simple as that. All right. Well, I'm going to tell you a little bit. Perhaps it's going to come as news to you about your normal food and about how natural it is. And let's talk about bananas. Banana is a very natural fruit. You know, it's the fruit that you give to your kids. You know, there's nothing more natural than a banana, all right? But I'll tell you what. The banana that you buy today is this one, your current varieties, all right? If you want the natural banana, here you have it. That's the natural banana. Anything weird about it? Anything you notice? Oh, it got seeds. Why would a plant want to have seeds? Aha! So what is it happening here? What is happening is that you don't want to have a bite of the banana and start spitting seeds. All right, so as humans, what have we done? Well, we've done the most unnatural thing you can think of. We've given it three copies of the genome. Now, anyone who knows about biology knows that you normally have two copies of the genome, one from your mom, one from your dad. Some plants have four copies, or six, or eight, or 22. But you never have an odd number of copies. That is so unnatural that nature is telling you, "My, you're not reproducing. You're not having seed. I'm not letting you." Well, it's very convenient for us, but not for the bananas. You can go to tomatoes, and you can see the tomato you buy every day in the market, all right? But you know what? You should meet the natural tomato. The natural tomato that you still find in South America, in the mountains, because it comes from there. That is the natural tomato. Or you can have a look, and look at this thing. This thing that doesn't look very familiar, does it? But what about this? Does it look familiar? Well, this is the natural maize. This is the maize that the cultures in Central America were eating. They were so important to them that there was a god for it, Concentrio. And that is the maize that they were eating, this one, not this. Now, but let's put it together. This is the one I'm talking about. This is the one you buy in the supermarket. Why is it that you have this one? Well, you have this one because in order to feed a family with this, you need a lot of plants, all right? But look, I got good news for you. I got good news for you because now everybody's mad about natural. Everything is natural. Your shampoo is natural. Your shirts are made of natural fibers. And I Googled it, and I found a big company in Australia who is selling toilet paper as all natural toilet paper. So everything is natural. Everything's got to be natural for you. And it's, you know, it's, to a point, it's all right. You know, nature is good to us. They give us air and sunlight. Nature will give us, you know, the food that you eat. But you know what? Nature will give us tsunamis. That would kill a quarter of a million people in one night. And you know what? There is nothing more natural than a tsunami. There's nothing man-made about it, all right? Oh, and nature, whoosh. Nature will give us malaria. Why? Oh, because we have this mosquito here, and the mosquito is got to eat, all right? So the thing is that nature is not good, and nature is not bad. Nature is neutral. For nature, everybody got the same rights. Why? Because the misconception is that we are the only sons of Mother Nature, and we're not. You see, this mosquito is also a son of Mother Nature, and Mother Nature is taking care of it. He's going to suck up blood from you, and if in the meantime they give you malaria, too bad for you, mate. So we've been eating food forever. This new biotech food is going to kill us because it's all new, and you know, I just want to go with my old food. And I'll give you a bit of a tale about the Chinese gooseberry who was brought to New Zealand in the 1900s. And somebody put a lot of breeding, a lot of effort into it, gave it a new name. And what did you get? You get the kiwi fruit in 1959. And what about the strawberries? And you're going to say, all right, Jimmy, that's not possible. Strawberries are very old. I know it. I've seen it in a movie. Cleopatra was eating strawberries, so, all right, fair enough. So, you got these strawberries that actually, they're an accident. There's an accidental cross of two different species, wild species. One coming from Virginia, one coming from Chile. And you might think, all right, look, they're plants, they expand their territories, the Virginians were going down, the Chileans were going up, they found themselves, I don't know, Central America, the Caribbean, have a romantic night, you know. And the new strawberries came. But I tell you what, it was romantic. It was romantic because it happened in Paris, all right? Or in the outskirts of Paris, in Versailles. In the Botanic Garden, they had this collection, they put these two berries together and accidentally crossed, and there you go, your strawberries. That actually happened in the middle of the 18th century. So next time you go to a movie and you see Cleopatra eating a strawberry, say, that's not right. All right? So what about your traditional food? Your traditional food, like potatoes in Europe, chilies in India. You know, there can't be an Indian food without chilies. You know, a curry is not a curry without chili. But cassava in Africa, guess what? They all come from South America. All right? What about safety? You know, this new biotech food, you know, is not safe because it's new, but, you know, the old food is totally safe. Like cassava, that can give you paralysis if you don't know how to process it. What about if you try to eat the natural banana? Well, if you try to eat the natural banana, and actually people does it in Cambodia, they have a big problem with bowel obstruction because they eat the seeds. Anyone got a coffee today? Well, a coffee's got thousands of chemicals. Somebody decided, I'm going to test 27 of them. And guess what? 19 of them were carcinogenic. So, perhaps your normal food is not as natural as you thought. Perhaps it's not as traditional as you thought. Perhaps it's not as safe as you thought. And perhaps it's not as old as you thought. But at least it's plentiful. I'll come back to that in a minute. Now, I need to define what is a GM plant. A lot of people don't know what a GM plant is. It's a complicated definition. A GM plant is a plant to which you have added a fragment, a little bit of DNA, but not in any way. You have to do it using precision techniques called genetic engineering. Now, if you add a lot of DNA, that is not. All right? So it's important to know what is not a GM plant. If you cross two plants, and you add thousands of genes, that's not GM. If you produce plants in tissue culture and create polyploids, giving them entire genomes, that's not GM. If you produce varieties by irradiation or using random mutagenesis, that is not GM. And you might say, well, these techniques give thousands of mutations, unknown mutations. And you might say, well, people don't do that. Ha-ha, people do. Many of the food that you have in the supermarket was created by irradiation or random mutagenesis. It was the flavor of the days in the 60s and 70s. Is it still down? So one of the main questions I get when I talk to people is about GM food. Are they safe? Well, the first conception people have is, you know, this food is just coming from science, or they're not natural, you know? And you gotta agree with me that I look pretty mad in this picture, all right? I really look like a mad scientist. And the funny thing is when I tell around and I say, look, that's how we do bananas, all right? You know, we do GM bananas. I grab them so they don't run away. And this guy actually injects the gene. And people go, wow, I didn't know it was that easy. Well, it wasn't that easy. It's very complicated. But people don't know about it. So obviously, they always ask me this question. Can you guarantee me, Jimmy, that there's going to be no risk eating GM food, and me being kind of a honest guy and say, no, I cannot. I cannot guarantee it. So the obvious conclusion is, well, don't make me eat it. I don't want to take the risk. You know, is absolutely no risk? No, there isn't. So I got to think about risky things that you do every day or you normally do. You know, one of them is driving. Well, I live in Kenmore. What is that? What is 10 km from here? And I drive. Drive is dangerous. You can have an accident, all right? But if I don't drive, it's going to take me 3 hours to get home, all right? Or you say, all right, I'm not driving. I'm just going to walk because driving is too dangerous. So you walk, and sooner or later, you're going to find a street, and you're going to have to cross it. And you're stuck in there, and you say, what do I do? Well, mate, if you don't cross the street, you're not getting home, all right? You say, well, never mind. I'm gonna move. I'm going to buy a house at the university campus. All right, so I don't have to cross the street. But you see, classes are in the morning, and if you walk under the sun, you get a fantastic skin cancer. You practice sport, I broke my foot doing windsurfing. You cook, you can burn yourself, you breathe, and you can get the flu. But are you going to stop breathing? So the thing is, pretty much everything you do, it's risky, because when you start thinking about the things that are not risky, and you think, and you think, and you keep thinking, you end up with the conclusion to say, mate, obviously I cannot promise you that there is absolutely zero risk in GM food, because there is absolutely no zero risk in anything you do in life. What do? You think about it, and you decide, is it worth it or not? So, tell you about classical breeding. Not GM, classical breeding. They got this celery variety, very healthy celery. Mom was a celery, dad was a celery. They crossed them. They got this variety that was so carcinogenic that farm workers got rashes in their skin. By the way, you don't need any permit to sell this. You don't need to try anything. So what about being plenty of food? Well, I got some bad news for you. The news are that in the next 2 generations, we will consume twice as much food as it has been consumed in the entire history of humankind. Depending on your belief, that's since Adam and Eve or since the monkeys came down from the trees. Twice as much food. And what? You're going to have to produce it. And we're beginning to see shortages of food. And we're beginning to see social unrest because food prices are going up. And you know what? For you, if a kilo of tomato costs $1.50 or $2.50, you don't even know, okay? For these guys, if a kilo of rice costs 10 cents or 15 cents, it's the difference between I'm eating and not eating. So for a lot of people who are not as fortunate as us, that is a problem. So what major crops do we have? Just some data for you. It's almost impossible to find any soybeans that are not GM anymore. Our cotton, and you say, but we don't eat cotton. Think again, because if you go and have some fish and chips, it's made with cotton oil. So you got mice, you got canola. If you want to talk about the commercial impacts, what is it that you have? Since GM food started in 1996, but there have been 1.5 billion hectares planted of GM food. Contrary to what a lot of people say, most of the farmers who grow GM food are small farmers. They are not huge multinationals. 90% are small farmers. Some of them from India, some of them from Australia. And if you look at the environmental impact, it's incredible that essentially GM crops have contributed to a huge gain in avoiding environmental impact of agriculture. One example is that 500,000 kilos of active ingredient have been saved by these crops. Remember, active ingredient is normally 1% of the total thing. All right? And now, the way that you give, you know, you go around in your field is you go and you spray. And this guy's got this mask. But you got to agree with me, that is not very good, all right? Some others are not so lucky. They don't have any masks. They're breathing it. And you know what? In case you didn't know, the incidence of cancer and respiratory diseases in farmers is a lot higher than in people who are not related to farm work. Why? Because they do this a lot. Now, In Australia, we don't do it. Our fields are too big, so we use airplanes. And when we use airplanes, you know, they're very convenient to fumigate, but they use a lot of fuel. So another of impacts that you have from this is that just in 2011 alone, not in the whole history, just in 2011, 23 billion kilos of CO2 was saved. And that is equivalent to 10 million cars off the road. You see, the previous speaker that you saw was talking about 2 million. This is 10 million cars in 1 year. So, I hope I've convinced you that GM is really the solution to all your problems, you know, hair loss, whatever, all right? The truth is no, it isn't. This is over-glorified. This is just one more technique, all right? It just happened to be a technique that is technically complicated and very difficult to explain it to your neighbors. And therefore, you do, whether you are in favor or against, you do have to respect the opinion of people who is afraid of them, because people are afraid of the things that they don't understand. And this is not easily understandable by people, all right? So my final remarks. Look, I hope I've convinced you that wherever you go, there's no such a thing as natural food anymore, all right? We do have a big problem. You might not realize it, but we do have a big problem. And a lot of governments, a lot of countries are really nervous about the whole thing. Mind you, we do have enough food today to feed humanity. People are hungry because of political problems, not because of agricultural problems, all right? But mind, in 50 years, that won't be the case, eh? GM is not the solution, and GM is not perfect. And I would say, anything that you can solve without using GM, you should. But you would be really silly not to use GM to solve problems that cannot be solved any other way. And of course, we need to have a logical debate. But the problem in this debate with GM food, most of the time, is that it uses a lot of theatricals. It doesn't use science. So you can have a debate, but you have to base your debate in science, not on beliefs. Because if you tell me, oh, look, GM food are not good because God told me, well, that's, you just killed it. Because what can I say? Can I say, like, can you please give me, do you have an email for God? Can you give me a phone number? Can I talk to your God? Can I talk to your God, all right, about, you know, this GM thing? Say, no, talk, you know, God talks through me, not through you, all right? And that should be a bit of a problem. But that doesn't mean that we don't have to respect those people that, even given the science, they decide not to have it. Because respect is number one. But you cannot tolerate people who will tell you, this is this because it is my belief, all right? Yeah. You can say, you can't have it, but you cannot tell me that is the reason for it. It's like when you go, you know, all these cows and like that. I respect vegetarians, all right? And I truly respect them. But it's your belief, you do it. But don't come to me to tell me I'm a vegetarian because I respect life. Because that is not true. If you respect life, you're going to have to eat rocks. You see, vegetarian is of the most inhuman people in this universe, if you look at it from the point of view of a tomato. All right? You see, look, a goat can run away from you. A cow can kick you when you try to, you know, kill it, all right, so you don't have a steak. But a tomato, it's growing. He can't run away from you. And you know what? You don't even kill it. You eat it alive. Come on. So don't give me that. Thank you very much.